Hey, Ray. Ray. Hey. Up here. Eyes up here. What the heck's the matter with you? Oh my gosh, Ray, I was just joking. Don't be so force sensitive. Simon Pegg says J.J. Abrams' answer to Ray's parentage was different from The Last Jedi. Now, this is shocking. This is shocking news. What can we glean from this title? Simon Pegg and J.J. Abrams are obviously close friends. Simon Pegg is a cultural icon at this point. Why? He starred in movies like my favorite, Shaun of the Dead. Writer, director, actor. And basically he is the king of geek culture. He's British. He's beloved all over the world. And so he is friends with J.J. Abrams. Oh, probably because of Star Trek, right? Okay, that makes sense. So J.J. Abrams, probably, one can surmise, watched The Last Jedi. And then Simon Pegg was like, yo, was that what you wanted Ray's parentage to be like? Is that the question, the answer to the question that you posed in The Force Awakens? And J.J. Abrams probably said, no. No. And Simon was like, damn, dude, chill. And J.J. Abrams was like, yo, dude didn't even talk to me about it. I had a whole thing. I had a whole plan that, that Ray came from Itchy or Lumpy, Chewbacca's family, I don't know, was her grandfather, something. He probably had something really, really, really cool. And by the way, it's about time to work the Chewbacca family into the movies. Everybody's waiting for it. Let's make it happen. So these two were making fun of Rian Johnson. That's what you can tell right away from this title. They were making fun of him, talking behind his back. Ever since Star Wars, The Force Awakens hit theaters, a big question on fans' minds has been regarding Rey's parentage. Daisy Ridley's Rey is, of course, the protagonist of this new trilogy. And The Force Awakens, in The Force Awakens, it's revealed that she was orphaned as a child by her new parents. Remember that? Yeah. Who remain hidden from view. Now, this is important because they remain hidden from view in order to imply that who they are might be a surprise. It might be interesting. Maybe they're two circus clowns. When Rian Johnson picked up the baton for Star Wars The Last Jedi, he came up with an answer to that question. And the answer is Rey's parents are people of no importance. All right, so thanks, Rian. Thanks for peeing all over any mystery or sense of wonder. Oh, I'm sure you have a good nihilistic reason for having done that. I'm sure it made sense to you. Yeah, let's move on. As revealed in the dramatic Rey Kylo Ren scene, they were just junkers, nobodies. This is played as a crushing fact that Rey always knew deep down, and when Kylo tries to use to lure her into joining him in creating a new world order. But the revelation backfires. Rey's parents aren't important. What's important is what's in her heart. Now, what's important is who she is now and what she's capable of. She's a nobody, quote unquote, who rose to prominence and to become a powerful Jedi. That in and of itself is a powerful story. Powerful. And it's the one Johnson chose to tell. It's funny how Rian Johnson keeps flipping the bird to other people's work, hard work on this franchise, and somehow stumbles on the more powerful story. Everything's always more powerful. Yeah. It's always the more subversive choice. He's always subverting things. Damn, dude, why is he always subverting my hard work? I don't know. But it sucks. For real, though. All right. That is most certainly the conversation that happened between those two creative titans. And okay, so let's say that is a powerful story. Let's play along. However, Fans have been curious as to whether this was Abrams' intention when he first introduced the idea of Rey's orphanage in The Force Awakens. We know there was no overarching plan for the trilogy that Johnson had to stick to. And so he picked up where The Force Awakens left off and crafted his own continuation of the story. But as Simon Pegg tells it on Josh Horowitz's Happy Sad podcast, as Simon Pegg talks on this podcast, The Last Jedi's answer to who are Rey's parents question may have undone what Abrams was thinking about doing with that particular thread. Yeah. You know, in if you are somebody who does improv comedy, there's a kind of theme or a theory called yes and. Whenever you're trying to improvise a scene with another actor, whatever he gives you, you're supposed to take and run with. It's called yes and. Never say no, but that would be basically killing the momentum of you know, any potential possibilities. If J.J. Abrams was basically saying, hey, Rey's parents were mysterious and therefore they might be interesting, they might be important. And then this jackass, Rian Johnson, comes in and goes, no, but it kind of screeches all momentum to a halt, all story potential. And think about it. Think about all the wonderful things. But the more subversive choice, the more powerful choice, is that Rey came from nowhere and she's entirely self-actualized. That's the Mary Sue answer. She did it all by herself. There's nothing special about her. She wasn't particularly raised well. Yeah. Well, let's get a quote. Well, I know what JJ kind of intended, or at least what was sort of being chucked around. I think that's kind of been undone slightly by The Last Jedi. I don't know. I think Unkar Plutt is Rey's real father. All right. That laugh was bitter. Oh, but it was bitter, but it also was kind of like, you hurt my friend. His friend being J.J. Abrams, who had a whole idea that was just basically tossed away in the garbage. Pegg obviously played Unkar Plutt in The Force Awakens, but he also contributed a bit to the script here and there, so he would know what ideas were being bandied about on set. And he goes further to say that the answer they were toying with would have been one of greater importance. There was some talk about, you know, a kind of relevant lineage for her, as there usually is in a Star Wars film. But I honestly don't know, and I don't know if anybody knows. We shall see. Nothing set in stone, per se. And just as Johnson picked up the baton from Abrams and ran it into the ground, Abrams is now picking up the baton from Johnson and crafting Episode 9 on his own. Oh, please. It's possible he retroactively undoes The Last Jedi's answer. He's got to. Oh my God, undo the whole thing. And it's also possible he doubles down on what Johnson came up with. I'm personally of the opinion that making Rey someone of important lineage is unexciting. Nobody... Adam Chitwood. Nobody asked you. Report the facts like I do. You don't see me inserting my opinions everywhere. But it seems like you're a jerk. I'm sorry. So I'm hoping we stick with what was introduced in The Last Jedi. Jesus. The wide-ranging podcast with Pegg is worth a listen, and the noted Star Wars superfan reveals that his feelings on the franchise have become a bit less passionate since actually working on and being in a Star Wars movie. The mystery is gone. That's sad. When I saw The Force Awakens, I had an odd sense of ennui during it. I felt kind of disappointed, and I couldn't figure out why. It ended at the premiere, and I felt down, and I was like, why do I feel down? And I realized it was because I'd been in it. I'd read the script, and I'd even contributed a little bit to the script here and there, so I'd been involved in it, so it wasn't a big surprise. So I watched the movie knowing everything that was going to happen, and so when that big thing happens to one of our favorite ever characters, it wasn't a surprise. I realized that the payoff for being in it was to have the experience of seeing it removed, and I wouldn't swap that because it was an amazing experience, but it was a strange one. He sounds depressed. I think all of us kind of feel that way, and none of us necessarily, probably none of us who were watching this were in Star Wars. Yeah. David Prowse might be watching this right now, to be honest with you. Hey, David, Christopher Reeves rules. Christopher Reeve rules. All right. Get confused with George Reeves. It happens. But this is sad. I mean, this is, he thinks he's blaming his feeling of depression and a loss of love of Star Wars on the fact that he was in it. It's not correct. It was just the movie. But, you know, ironically, it's like now I'm just, you know, it gets worse and worse. So now J.J. Abrams was terrible in The Force Awakens. But he was light years back. I mean, okay, so wait. George Lucas was dreadful in the prequels. Dreadful. And you can tell me now those prequels were great. Oh, how dare you not like those prequels. No, they sucked. They sucked. But compared to J.J. Abrams, now I like them. And I hated J.J. Abrams. But now compared to Rian Johnson, I love J.J. Abrams. I mean, as we descend deeper and deeper into Kathleen Kennedy's black book of inexperienced, subservient, suck-up, sycophantic directors, the ones that came before are forgiven. I mean, it's really unreal. That's a curious revelation. No, it isn't, but one that makes sense. It'll be interesting to see if Pegg returns to work on episode 9 in some capacity, or if he maintains his distance so as to keep the viewing experience pure. That's what I'm doing. I'm maintaining my distance to keep the experience pure. Whatever the case, we all find out how Abrams decides to conclude this new trilogy when Star Wars Episode 9 hits theaters Christmas of 2019. Yeah, it just gets worse and worse. I mean, the backbiting that is between the lines of this article. People who are feeling betrayed by Rian Johnson's work. His own peers now are stepping forward to criticize, if not outrightly condemn, his movie and the way that it basically, it just shut the door on all kinds of stuff that could come in the future. Thank you, Rian Johnson. Hey, maybe this? Rian Johnson. No. To none of that. None of that. Go to hell, Rian Johnson.